This is an animation we'll build in Adobe After Effects, and we'll link the whole thing up to a web page. And as someone scrolls through the page, the animation will follow their scroll position. Now, we're going to cover this from the very beginning, so if you've never used After Effects before, we'll cover everything you need to know to get started. And six things. We'll set up our composition in After Effects, we'll build the animation, we'll export it, we'll bring it into Webflow and put it inside our layout, we'll configure a trigger, this is what tracks the scroll position on the page, and finally, we'll link our animation to that trigger. Let's get started in After Effects. And to open After Effects, open After Effects. That's step one. Except it isn't. Let's continue. And something to consider when setting up a composition in After Effects, this is the starting point, but you can always make changes later. You can change dimensions, you can change timing, frame rate, but for this example, let's choose 1000 by 1000. Frame rate doesn't matter too much for a continuous animation like this. Let's choose 60 so we can approximate what it might look like on a common browser. Same deal with duration, not critical. We can use anything here. And finally, let's set the background color to black. When we hit OK, everything's ready to go. If we want to go back and make a change, we can right-click on our composition and access the settings. Let's change our background color to white, since this more closely matches the design we're going for. That's step one. Step two is where things get really interesting. Let's start by creating the outer orbital path for this animation. Now, we're going to build this in a few different stages. We're not going to animate until we've set up everything in our composition. So to do that, let's first adjust our zoom. We're going to fit up to 200%. And down here, where the layers usually appear, we're going to right-click. We're going to go to New, Shape Layer. And from this, we can create any shape we want. What happens if we preview right now, if we hit play? Nothing. You can't see anything because we haven't defined what that shape is. So let's open up using this arrow. And we'll go to Add. From Add, we'll select Ellipse. Now we have an ellipse shape, but if we hit play again, nothing. We have to define either a stroke or a fill or something else for this path. So let's go to Add for a second time. Let's do a stroke. And if we go to Preview now, still absolutely nothing. Except there is, we just can't see it. That's because the stroke color is white. Let's change the stroke color to a light gray. And if we hit play, we can see exactly what's going on. Okay, let's make our stroke 1 pixel, so it's really thin, and we'll go to the ellipse path. We can hit the arrow next to that and adjust the size. This is going to be our outer orbital path, or our outermost planet. So we're going to bring this almost all the way to the edge. That's our outer orbital path. And if we click on the layer here and hit return, we can call it orbital path. This way we can keep things organized. And also, for a stylized look, let's add one more thing. Let's add a fill, and we'll choose the fill color here. Let's make it black. And we can actually open up fill here to affect opacity. And we'll drop the opacity all the way down to maybe 3%. That looks pretty good. That's our first orbital path. So now that we've created one, we can just copy and paste. So we'll paste the second one. And all we'll do is go into contents here, into ellipse path, and adjust its size. We'll bring this one in a little bit. Now, why are we adjusting size on the ellipse path itself instead of going into transform and affecting something like scale? Well, the reason we're doing that is because we don't want the stroke we put around the ellipse. If we transformed, if we scaled everything down, that stroke, which is 1 pixel, would also scale down as well. We want a consistent stroke. So we're using the ellipse path size property here. Let's actually make that a little bit smaller. So our outer orbit and the next orbit are a little bit farther spaced apart. That looks pretty good. So let's copy and paste again, and we'll go in here, just going into contents, ellipse path, and adjusting the size. Same thing for the next planet, just copy and paste. We'll bring this one in a little bit more, contents, ellipse path, size. And we'll speed this part up now in post so you don't have to sit through every manual adjustment. And that's it, 7 orbital paths. That means we'll have 7 different planets. Let's Command A or Control A on PC to select all, and then we can just hit the arrow here to collapse all of them. We have 7 orbital paths, each of them representing the path a planet will take as it rotates around that star. Speaking of the star, let's create a star. And rather than doing this from scratch, let's use Orbital Path 7 as a template. We'll copy and paste it. open up. And we'll make some changes here. So for the contents, let's do what we've done with the others and make this a lot smaller. This will be the star itself. We'll put that right at the center. And we'll click on the label and hit return star. And let's zoom in so we can see what we're doing. Let's go into 800%. And we'll use the same stroke color here, but we want the fill to be a little bit different. In fact, we want the fill itself. Let's go in and choose a color of white. We want the fill itself to have an opacity of 100%. So if we zoom out, we can see the star right at the center. That looks pretty good. So that's our star. Let's collapse that. And we'll use the same type of design for our planets, but there's a little bit of a difference with the planet. Let's copy and paste. We'll call this one return planet. And for our planet, we're going to go into contents and we'll adjust two things for each planet. The first thing we'll adjust is the size. We don't want it as large. So let's make this one, let's say 15, but we'll also adjust its position. So for now, let's just move this position right here on top of the first orbital path. Let go. Let's click out. That looks pretty good. We want it just balanced right on that orbital path. Let's copy and paste for the second planet. Let's go in, contents, and we're going to randomize the size a little bit. Maybe this one will be 20, and we'll update its position to go right over here. Now, that might be a little close to the third orbital path, so let's make it something like 18. Click out. That looks pretty good. So copy and paste, planet 3. Again, we're going to speed this up in post so you don't have to sit through each planet. And that's about it for our 7 planets. So now that everything's placed as it needs to be placed, let's talk about anchor points. Now, the reason we used position here inside of the contents is because the anchor point, which is indicated right here in the center, that little crosshair, that anchor point is the point from which everything will rotate. So if we adjust rotation, let's start on planet 7 here. If we open up transform and we adjust rotation, we'll see that it actually orbits. Let's actually adjust this to fit up to 200%. This orbits around the star. So because the anchor point is the center, that's the point around which everything orbits. Now, if we were to move the entire layer, let's affect the position on the entire layer. Let's move it over here. You can see the anchor point is changing position too. Now, if we rotate with that moved anchor point, that's the new place around which everything orbits. Let's Command Z and undo a couple times so we can get our anchor point back. That looks pretty good. Now, notice how as we grab the playhead and move right and left and right and left, nothing's animating. We want to create keyframes for that to happen. And the way we can do that is going to the first frame here, frame 0, we're going to click on the stopwatch next to rotation. So that's going to create our first keyframe. You can see that keyframe right there was automatically created. This still isn't animated yet, but we've basically set that first point. That first keyframe is indicating that that rotation is at 113 degrees. What happens if we move the playhead all the way to the end, to the last frame, and we affect our rotation? Let's crank that up to maybe 275 degrees. So if we do that and then grab our playhead and move left and right, we can see the planet is in orbit around that anchor point. So that looks pretty good for planet 7. We might want planet 7 to orbit even more. So if we go above 360, you can see right here where it says rotation, once we hit 360, it actually changes to 1 revolution plus 0 degrees. Because after 360, it's done 1 full revolution. So this is now 1 full revolution plus 77 degrees and so on. Let's end it right there and take a look at that outer planetary orbit. That looks pretty good. Okay, that's planet 7. Let's do planet 6. We'll go into transform and we'll affect its starting rotation point. Maybe we want it to start over here and we'll add our first keyframe by clicking on the stopwatch, go to the end and we'll rotate. Let's test that out. Looks pretty good. Now, you might not be able to see because of the zoom level and the contrast, you might not be able to see each of these orbital paths as we're previewing them. So it can help to keep the planet you're working with selected, or it could help to change our composition settings. We could just choose a different background color for right now. Let's change the background color to black. Let's hit okay. Now we can see a little better what's going on. So if we click out, we can take a look at our orbital paths, the planets orbiting around that star. That's 2 planets. Now we're going to speed up again and do the other 5. And that looks pretty good. We can keep tweaking if we'd like, but let's hit spacebar from the first frame to preview what the animation will look like. Okay, let's change the background color back, go to composition settings, we'll choose white background because that's the layout we're eventually going to use as we integrate it to the web page. Let's go to the beginning, take a look there. And that looks pretty good. We can move forward from there. Now, After Effects, just like Photoshop or Cinema 4D or DaVinci Resolve, these are all applications that have tons of options. There's no right or wrong way to use them. And that's an important consideration. You may know of, or you may discover a totally different way to build this. And that's a beautiful thing. Okay, step three, we've built our animation, let's export it. Now, we're using a plugin called bodymovin to take our After Effects composition and turn it into a single JSON file. We can find that in Window, Extensions, bodymovin. We have a separate video which shows how to install the bodymovin extension, so check that out if you haven't already. We'll want to make sure our composition is actually selected, and we should set a destination folder. This is where the export is going to save the file. And when we're done, press render. That's it. That's step three. Step four, let's import that exported file into Webflow. We have a side-by-side layout here we built in a grid. And if you haven't built a site in Webflow before, we have tons of teaching resources, videos, articles. All of this is on Webflow University, and it's all free. So check that out if you haven't already. But we'll simply drag our animation into the left part of this grid. And if we were to publish this site as is, it'd actually work okay. It's up there on the top, but it's animating. We'll fix up the layout first, but then we'll make sure to tie this animation to our scroll position instead of just playing automatically when the page loads. Okay, out of preview mode. To position this so it's vertically centered, we're going to use a trick. We'll use a div block, a div, which is just a box. And we can drag the div block into our grid right here. And once we do, we can put our Lottie animation, the thing we exported from After Effects, right inside that div block. And if we preview now, it's exactly the same. Out of preview. It didn't change anything because we haven't told the div block how to behave. Let's set its height to 100% of the viewport. That's 100 VH. And we're almost there, just a few more changes. We're going to enable flexbox. This lets us align and justify content to the center. So let's align and justify content, and it's done. Regardless of the size of our viewport, this animation will be at the vertical center. Magic? Not at all, because we just demonstrated exactly how it's done. Now, one more thing. If we scroll, the animation is stuck there at the top. It scrolls with all the headings and paragraphs and even the fake buttons. But what if we make the div block, that div block we created, what if we make that sticky? And what if we make sure it sticks starting at 0 pixels from the top? So it'll essentially stick right away. Let's try it out in preview mode. While we scroll, the animation is staying in the perfect center the whole time. That's step four. Step five, we're almost done. This is the big part. We're going to set up a scroll-based trigger. Over in interactions, we'll add a trigger. There are two types of triggers. A trigger is just something, an event upon which an animation is, for the lack of a different term, triggered. If you want an animation to start when you click something, clicking that thing, that's a trigger. If you want an animation to start on page load, the page itself loading, that's the trigger. In this case, we want the trigger to be on the page. We want this animation to progress as we're scrolling through the entire page. So we'll select that option. And we're almost there. This is the last part. We want to create a new animation for this. While we're scrolling, we want our After Effects animation to animate. And there are two parts here. There's 0% when we're at the top of the page, and there's 100% when we've scrolled to the bottom of the page. We want to make sure our Lottie animation, the planets, we want to make sure that's selected. And we'll simply add a keyframe, an action, to control our playback. And two things showed up, one at 0 and another at 100. At 0, we're basically at the beginning of the animation. At 100, let's go in and make sure we're at the end of our animation. Too easy? We'll see. And let's go into preview mode. And as we scroll, it works exactly as expected. But that's it. We set up the After Effects composition, we animated, we exported, we added our animation to Webflow, we configured the trigger, and finally, we set up our animation so it would tie into where we scrolled on the page. Now, there are trillions of things you can do with this. We have the full course available on Webflow University, but that's a basic scroll-based animation in the Webflow Designer.